about things, don't take them as product commitments. Look at them as a research vision of where we could be some years from now. There's a second part to this disclaimer, and you can see this in my title. Actionable knowledge from the fusion of data. It's wordy, it's precise, it's in danger of being impenetrable. So instead, I'm going to retitle my talk, Just Knowledge Graphs. Has anybody heard of knowledge graphs? Could you raise your hand if you have? A few. Knowledge graphs have been for at least 5 years a very big topic for the big technology companies. And what I want to talk about is why they're relevant to us and our industry and how they link to this idea of the power of open, how they support openness. A word about how my talk is going to go, and the title will give you a hint there. I'll try and be personable for the first 5 minutes and give you an easy road in. And then you might find yourself thinking for 10 minutes, I'm giving too much detail. I'm really losing you. So at the 15-minute mark, we're going to give you a demo, and if the demo gods smile on me, I'll pull you back, and you'll think, yeah, I see where this is going. And then I'm going to explain how we built the demo, and there might be another 10 minutes where you think, is this guy doing it deliberately? Is this an act of Brechtian alienation live on stage? Why would you do this at a technology conference? But please, bear with me, and I hope that you'll see, as I start to explain how we've built this, how this fits with the vision of cloud and data that Kevin and Steve were laying out before lunch until the lightning strike. And if you follow me that way, I hope that what I end up presenting is a vision of where we can be in the future by bringing together cloud and data. And then right at the end, I'll flip the script entirely on this idea of research and this disclaimer. So let's see how that goes. So I've been working with graphs, with the mathematical idea of what a graph is, since the last century. My research has always had something to do with graphs. Can you raise your hand if you have any idea what that means, a mathematical object called a graph? Thanks, Tom. Okay. Most people are exposed to graph theory in recent years with the example of social networks. I'm going to start there. And I'm going to start with what I'm tagging classic Facebook. So when Facebook started, it was a friendship network between people. And if you wanted to draw that in a diagram, you would draw the two people and draw a line between them if they're friends, if they're connected by friendship. So there's me and Björn, the CTO of Milestone. I'm going to add a couple of my friends that I'd like to tell you something about, a chap called Dan Brickley and a chap called Denny Vrandicic. And to complete this diagram, which is a graph, it's the mathematical structure, Dan and Denny are also friends with one another. Now, graph theorists in mathematics can already tell you a couple of interesting things in analyzing that graph. The first is this triangle at the bottom of three people who are all mutual friends with one another is literally called a triangle in graph theory. Three things that are all connected to one another. Mathematicians also define a notion called degree, which is how many connections each node has. So Björn sitting up there on his own at the top has one connection. Dan and Denny have two each. I'm in the middle, and I've got a degree of three, and that makes me to some degree prominent in this graph. Okay? So much for Facebook. Let's look at Twitter. So here are the three of us on Twitter. Here's another account called Wikidata. And you might expect that you use the same graph to model this and just draw a line for us following that account. That's not actually the right model for Twitter. The right graph is one that has a directed relationship for me following Wikidata. And you can see the distinction when you see Denny follows Wikidata, but Wikidata follows Denny back. Dan follows Wikidata, and Wikidata follows Dan back. And just to complete the picture, I follow Dan follows Denny, Denny follows me, I follow Denny follows Dan follows me. Okay, so what? Let's look at that notion of degree again. Because we have directed relationships, there's an idea of an out degree, how many people you follow, and an in degree, how many people follow you. Okay? And here's where I lose prominence, because everybody else has a higher in degree than me. They're more prominent in this network. What does that have to do with technology? That is the notion on which Google was founded. My screen is going off. I'll move over here. So what Google did, using the compute resources at Stanford, was crawled the entire web and built a graph using the hyperlinks between pages. And then they took the technology of companies before, like AltaVista, where you type in a search term and they look up pages that match those search terms. But they responded to what AltaVista was struggling with, which is ranking those pages. Yeah? As the web grew, there were far too many pages that would match your search. What became important was how you rank them. And Google ranked them well enough that the first page, the first 10 results, gave very often what people were looking for. They did that by extending this idea of in degree. If people point at you, if people link at you, you're very prominent in a graph. If you extend that, if someone who themselves is prominent links to you, you gain even more prominence. And that's PageRank, and that's the foundation of Google. Having mentioned these big tech companies, I'm going to tell you why I'm talking about one of these people. Dan Brickley came up with this approach called FOF, friend of a friend. He said, why on the web, when we can all produce our own content, do we give away this valuable graph information about our friendship network into these silos, into Facebook, into Twitter? They're separate from one another, and they own our data. The open data approach is rather to say, I define this, and I decide what of the network that I've defined among my friends do I give to Facebook, what do I give to Twitter, and what do I give to other people? And I want to talk about the technology based on graphs that allows this open data sharing and this control of who you give what data to. In order to get there, I'm just going to go back to Facebook one more time. Okay, then I'm going to stop talking about social networks. Go back to this idea of the three people on Facebook, and I'm going to redraw using these directed relationships between us. And we're mutually friends with one another, so there's an arrow both ways, and I'm going to label that as a friendship relationship. What Facebook did a few years later was said, there are some people that are so prominent, so famous, like Sir Tim Berners-Lee, or to we, his acquaintances, Timbal, that they don't, that they won't allow him to accept any more friends. They have a limit to the degree in the network. If you hit, I think it's 50,000 friends, you can't accept any more friends. So Facebook introduced this second idea of, rather than being friends, you can have a one-way relationship called the like, okay? And any number of people can like Tim Berners-Lee, but that's not a mutual relationship. Might sound like a minor tweak, minor technical tweak, but things ballooned a little bit from there. So to start with, users started saying, I know Facebook was literally supposed to be a college Facebook for people, but since we can like things, why don't we put other things on that network? Why don't we make pages? And there is a page on Facebook for Milestone Systems. You can go and like it right now. It doesn't guarantee that we will like you back, but of course we do like you back. We're a great community. The next step, around 2010, was Facebook saying, why not extend that notion even further? And they published a protocol that they called Open Graph, which meant that anybody with a web page could put a Facebook like button on it. And Facebook would capture the like relationship. When they announced it, they made a big deal of Netflix and Spotify are a good target for this. So my example would be, I could like the song Norwegian Wood on Spotify, and Facebook capture that relationship, which is really useful to them from an advertising point of view. In graph data terms, what it means is that Spotify are free to and do create a different kind of graph linking there. So Spotify, important data for them is, well, who recorded this song? Of course, it was the Beatles. So they introduce a new relationship in their graph called buy. Okay, all of that was to get to the point where I can define, last complicated term, ontologies. Who's heard of ontologies? Milestone have definitely heard of ontologies. It's been on the radar a lot this year. Ontologies, I would give an informal definition, help you to define these graphs. They define three things. A set of classes, what kind of things do you model in your graph? So the kind of things in this one are people, companies, songs, and music artists. They define the relationships that you put in a graph. So here, that's friendship, liking, and recording music. And then, at their most powerful, they define inference, what can be inferred from facts that aren't explicitly stated. So the fact that I like Norwegian Wood, and Norwegian Wood was recorded by the Beatles, we can infer from that that I like the Beatles. Now, the accepted definition of ontologies is a formal, explicit specification of a shared conceptualization. The shared conceptualization is this, what kind of things do we talk about, and what kind of relationships exist between them? That was a definition made by a chap called Tom Gruber, and refined by Rudy Studer. Denny and I, the other people in this graph, used to work for Rudy, but what about Tom? He's the top of my whatever happened to list here. Tom, after defining ontologies, went on to found a company called Siri Inc., developed the Siri personal assistant, and sold that to Apple. Not bad for that start. Dan Brickley took this idea that he started with FOF of exposing open data using web technologies and was a heavy contributor to something called schema.org. Schema.org is arguably the largest used ontology on the web. You can mark up all of these pages with a concept of what they represent and involve them in relationships using open data. Dan now works at Google maintaining that, but Google were just one of the companies that started that. In fact, all the major search companies. So Microsoft with Bing, Yahoo, Yandex, and Google got together and said, let's define this ontology together so that we can mark up the web. Denny, after being in Rudy Studer's group, he went on to join the Wikimedia Foundation and to be the founder of a project called Wikidata. I'm not going to ask who's heard of Wikidata. Wikidata formed the basis of Google's announcing that search was now driven by a knowledge graph. The largest part of the knowledge graph that drives Google comes from this open data set called Wikidata, where anybody, you or I, can both define the ontology or the things in it, the things that are modeled in it. You can go and enter information right now. Denny also moved to Google, where he's now the Wikimedian in residence maintaining Wikidata. Why is this timely? And then I'll tell you why it's relevant. It's timely because as we're starting the conference here, as we're starting MIPS here, just across the country, a conference called AAAI is just winding up. AAAI is pretty much the longest running AI conference in existence. It's been running for 41 years. It has a new president this year, Yolanda Gill, and in her presidential address, she looked back on four decades of AI research, and for each decade, she pointed out what, from her point of view, were the watershed moments during that decade. And looking back at the 2010s, she nominated Siri, Google Knowledge Graph, and Wikidata as three of those watershed moments, and went further and said, already by 2016, Google's Knowledge Graph was used in a third of the 100 billion searches that they were doing every month, a number that's just grown. She also said last year, Wikidata, this open graph of open data, passed 8 billion relationships between the things that are modeled there and 880 billion edits over its lifetime. That's a lot of work going into this open data set that anybody can use. So, if you saw Kevin's talk last year, you would hear him talk about the big four tech companies in terms of GAFA. And you might notice that I've talked about Google, I've talked about Apple, I've talked about Facebook, but the last A I haven't talked about so far. That's what's to come. So that was enough of me getting into too much detail. Now, as set up to the demo, I want to remind, if you saw me last year, I was talking about a project called SafeCare, a collaborative project where Milestone take part, and we work on cyber physical security in the hospital domain. We work with three hospitals in Europe, in Marseille, France, in Amsterdam, in Netherlands, and a whole region of hospitals in Italy. If you happen to see MIPS in Copenhagen, and if not, I recommend go and look at it, you might remember also one of the research team was on stage in Copenhagen in full VR gear manipulating a virtual model of a corridor in our headquarters and saying, okay, if I have this immersive model from a 3D scan of the corridor, can I use that to do device placement within that corridor? This year, we have gone much further than just a corridor. We have an entire virtual hospital. Okay? So you can see here, there's a hospital, four floors, large building. We also have a model inside the hospital, but within that environment, we have virtual devices. So there's a virtual camera, a virtual smoke detector, a virtual access control on the double doors that get you through the hospital, and there a sprinkler with a heat detector. Okay? As you move around, you can see the lift, and you can see a couple of areas of the hospital, a couple of areas of the back office where there's further access control. So in terms of a live demo, can we go to the two HDMI feeds? Those are up there. Okay, so first things first. Over on stage right, you can see a souped up, a refined version of Smart Maps. And this is running in a web browser. It's running live on AWS, as you might guess already. This is the front of the hospital, the double doors where you go through, where the public can go through. Past reception, there is a camera which is trained on this set of double doors, which has an access controller right there. If you then look to the left, look at stage left, those four cameras within this virtual environment are producing live video feeds within that environment, which have been picked up in the current smart client. So you can see on camera one, there's that view past reception. Two and three give us further views of the reception area, and camera four gives us the, camera two gives the back office area. Okay, I didn't notice him. So at the double door, a doctor is currently trying to get through the access control through the double doors. Unfortunately for him, his card doesn't work. But luckily, that virtual access control device has a digital twin here right on stage with this access controller. So what I'm going to do is use the power of open to validate against that access control device. And now, in any second on the video, yeah, the door's open. The doctor goes through. But unfortunately here, a second figure clad in motorcycle gear tailgates through the door before it closes, okay? And now if we look at stage right, you see the smart map has responded to what just happened. So the doors opened, two figures went through, it raised up here a tailgate alarm, but that tailgate alarm has further visualization. It shows me in this back office area that there are now three vulnerable rooms that the tailgater has access to, okay? The tailgater doesn't yet have access to these two rooms because they have more access control, and I'm definitely not going to let him through. But our intruder has a trick up his sleeve. So he, by arson or by setting off an alarm at least, causes a fire, and here on the smart map you can see the fire sensor already causing that alarm. He has already run into a back room because the door sprang open because this is on the fire exit route. And you'll see here in the smart clients, this vulnerability assessment was updated in real time to say now emergency room 1 and 2 are also vulnerable to his attack because of that extra opening under the fire sensor conditions. So if I can go back to my slides. As a result of having this situational intelligence, we can see that as he's on his way out of the back doors that have also been opened, these officers arrive to apprehend him. If you look through the window, you can see they've been looking at this interface on the mobile display, and they're going to apprehend him, and all is good. So how did I build it? Here's where I'm in danger of going into too much detail. Don't try and read the detail on this. There is one clear take-home message here. There's an on-prem part. On-prem, side stage, is the video management system and the on-rail engine that's simulating this environment and those sensors. Everything else that went into building this demo is based in the cloud, is based on AWS. And I don't want to talk about the whole architecture. I rather want to bring these four parts out. Okay? So the first of these might not come as a surprise if you heard me talking last year. Many cloud providers have a managed Kubernetes service where you can run compute in containers. Okay? Naturally, we're going to use that again. Amazon also offer MSK, so managed streaming via Kafka. And the important point for both of these is managed. These are PaaS services, in the terms that Kevin talked about, and they are horizontally scalable independently of Milestone. If we give the functionality built on top of these services, Amazon can look after scaling the two things that these are used for, which I'm going to tell you about. The third thing is something called AppSync, which is how we build interfaces with this, and the pitch that I'll give is the technology that we use there is the right one to have open APIs that go beyond what we currently offer in the platform towards a sharing of data and data modeling. And finally, we use an AWS service called Neptune, which is a graph database. So to explain how we use them, here is the floor plan, or the part of the floor plan that I concentrate on, and I want to relate that to what I was just saying about graphs. So if you were to naively think, how would we model this as a graph, you might say, okay, you have that hallway where reception is at the front, and you have a hallway at the back. And they're connected, so you draw a line. Hallway 2 also connects to this uncontrolled room, observation room 1, and to this controlled room, access controlled room, emergency room 1. So we start to fill out a graph of the floor plan of the connection between the rooms, and then we think about, well, the important thing from a security point of view, from an integrated security point of view, is the devices. So there's a camera in hallway 1, so we might make that link in the graph. There are these 3 fire sensors in hallway 2, so we can attach them. But now if we look at the access control on that double door between the two hallways, there's a little bit of a quandary. Where do we attach that? Because it has different relationships. In one sense, it's in hallway 1, it's by reception. That's how you get to use your card to get through to the back of the hospital. But more importantly, it controls that ability to move between hallway 1 and hallway 2. Now, instead of making this up as I go along, which is what I'm demonstrating here, this is where the idea of ontologies come in and why we want to talk more about ontologies and how that relates to data modeling and to database APIs. So we built an ontology for buildings. It's got a central concept of building. It has a relationship between buildings and a concept of floors. We know already from the smart client, this is exactly how we organize this knowledge. Floors have a relationship to a concept of location, which might be a little bit unfamiliar. The reason for that is we reuse another ontology that we already defined called a grid ontology, where location is already defined. And the grid ontology says there are two types of location that are important to us. One is a zone, which in the hospital sense is a room or a hallway, areas where people can move around. And there's also an intersection is a location. This is how you get between zones. We didn't originally define this grid ontology for hospitals or even for buildings. We defined this ontology because we were looking at traffic and traffic control as a use case. In the traffic setting, a zone would be a road segment where traffic can move around, and an intersection between zones would literally be a traffic intersection. But you can see that there's something in common between buildings and road networks in that way. We can sense what's happening. Are there people? Are there events like fires or accidents within zones? But we can do more at intersection. We can control it. In a building, you control an intersection with access control. In a traffic network, you control an intersection with traffic signals. Okay? So we had already defined this part of ontology that says you distinguish these types of location and you use this relationship called leads to make a data model so you can understand what's happening across those grids. So instead of doing this ad hoc modeling, we then get this guidance from the ontology that you should explicitly model the door and you should use a relationship called leads to. So when we want to add devices, no surprise, we also define a device ontology. And no surprise being Milestone, that the primary kind of device that we started thinking about was cameras. But then we define a whole family of conceptual devices called sensors, of which one is, is fire sensor. Another one is access control. Now, if you look at the top, all devices have a relationship with location called located at, but access control devices have another relationship called controls access to. So again, the ontology guides us how we should refine this model. Cameras are simply located in zones. Our fire sensors are located at zones, but the access control is both located at a zone and controls access to an intersection. And when the ontology has shown us how to model the data that way, then that's an easy pattern to repeat and extend. So we carry on introducing more doors and more zones or rooms. And the important distinction there is one of those doors, the one to the emergency room, has an access controller. The other one doesn't. So you start to see how we built that demo where we said, once you have tailgated into a certain zone, where can you get to from there, given that there are only certain doors and some of those doors have access control? It's this kind of logical model that lets us build that situational intelligence. What Amazon lets us do is use this service that I mentioned, a graph database called AWS Neptune, and take such a graph model and simply load it. So this is background static information about the building and the devices and where the devices are set up and configured. We load into this graph database, and it has some interesting characteristics. It supports a standard, and I'll explain this in a second, called RDF, and it also supports a standard called Sparkle. So when I was talking about open data technologies, and I deliberately mentioned Tim Berners-Lee, Tim Berners-Lee founded W3C, or the World Wide Web Consortium, to be the guardian and maintainer of standards like HTML, and then XML, and latterly, RDF and Sparkle. RDF stands for Resource Description Framework. It's a serialization of graphs in different interchangeable formats. I'm going to skip over the fact that you can represent them in XML or in a native format, and concentrate on the fact that you can define and exchange these graphs using JSON. So exactly that representation that people use in REST APIs that Anna Spohr was just talking about. That is the de facto exchange format for open data. Okay? Other people do graphs, but those people don't give their graphs away. if you give your graphs away to partners and you allow further information to be integrated into them, you want to use this format, and this is the format supported on AWS. Similarly, Sparkle is, by a little joke among the community, recursively defined as Sparkle protocol and RDF query language. So it's a query language built for those exchangeable graphs. That allows retrieval of, among other things, subgraphs matching a query. For instance, the one that I just illustrated, if you've got to hallway 2, what else can you get to, or what else can you get to given the presence of access control in some locations? Or even more, given the state of access control, given that under certain conditions like fire, we might change the access. Okay, so much for Neptune. So much for static data. That's useful, but it's not the whole picture. What I demonstrated was something live where things are happening all the time and they're coming from many devices, not just the cameras, which are typically managed by Milestone, but from access control, from fire sensors, from anything could integrate here, and it's the dynamic data that is really interesting. So we go back to an ontology and say, we want to define a notion of event. An example of event is access control, and access control comes with a little bit of data that says, was this a positive access control? Did the card get authorized? Was the PIN correct? Or was it not authorized? There's an event, of course, for fire. So a fire sensor can raise an event according to either heat or smoke. There is a notion of door transition. So this is an event that would be produced by video analytics, okay? We've just seen you have Bosch embedded cameras already that can do person recognition and tracking. It's a fairly simple analytics task to say, have we tracked a person going through a door and raise an event called a door transition? Last, there's a whole set of events called alarms. These are the things that want to be that we want to bring to the user's attention. A type of alarm is a fire alarm, and that's a good example of why you would link back to an event to say the fire alarm's going off because there is heat detected here and here and smoke detected there. So we want to put together what events told us that. And the one that I'm going to concentrate on is this tailgate alarm at the start of the demo. And I'll go back to Amazon technology. So I said there is an open source project called Kafka. Kafka is a message broker. One can publish events, and many people can subscribe to those events. The managed version of that on Amazon, which is horizontally scalable, which you don't need to manage explicitly, Amazon will manage on your behalf. It's a PaaS service. We can publish to Kafka those events according to the ontology that I just described. So an access control event is right there saying, this comes from access control 1, from the double doors in the hospital. And the target of the event is the door that controls access to. And then with video analytics, we can produce that door transition event, saying that same door had someone go through it, but then we get a second event. Someone else goes through the door without there being another authorization from the access control. So meanwhile, we're running in the managed Kubernetes service on Amazon, an event processing service that subscribes to these events and sees that exact pattern, so an access followed by 2 transitions instead of an access and a transition, then another access control, then a transition, which is normal, and it raises the alarm. And it does that by simply putting another message on the Kafka service on cloud, to which many people might subscribe. One of the subscribers is the user interface that I just showed. Okay. Here's the last bit of Amazon technology that we're looking forward to using, that we're demonstrating the utility of. That's one called AppSync. AppSync is about making APIs, so making interaction points between software for integration, the way that we currently do with the MIP SDK. AppSync supports something really interesting, where I come back to Facebook. Facebook have gone now a little bit beyond that open graph approach that I started with and said, when you model the world as graphs, when graphs are what are important, traditional REST services that just try to preempt what you might ask for in an API and give you a fixed payload, they're not a good mix. Actually, clients can be much more intelligent about what they're looking for from an API call. Instead of giving them everything in the kitchen sink, they can ask, using this data model that's understood, that's in common in the graph, they can request exactly what they want. AppSync goes a little bit further. It doesn't just let you build those GraphQL-based APIs. It also integrates with Kafka, so you can subscribe to an ongoing set of events using a graph pattern and say, this is the kind of thing that I'm interested in, putting together, infusing. GraphQL lets you both ask for what you want and also understand what your changes mean, and Kafka lets you say, tell me when these kind of things happen. Yeah? So we can form, using these managed services, these event processing services that say, tell me when these kind of things happen at a door, and then this is what I will inform you back about. So in a scalable way, we can build that kind of processing that was demonstrated there with the tailgate alarm, but we can do that in an open way. We can share this information about the setting and the devices, and as a community, build those kind of services together. It's not that Milestone are going to build tailgating. It's not that Milestone are going to build traffic control. It's rather this approach to modeling and sharing data allows the whole community to build these things more easily. Okay, I think this is timely, not least because just last week, a working group was announced on how to put together those two technologies that I've talked about, the RDF models for open data that Neptune consumes, and GraphQL, which we're using with AppSync. This is the right combination of technologies for people working to build data-oriented applications. Now, finally, when I started, I said that a research talk, you shouldn't take anything that I say as a product commitment. I'm just looking at where could we get, what could we build in future. This year is slightly different. So the user interface that I showed you, where you have something beyond what smart maps can do at the moment, where you have multiple device types, where you have alarms that cover not just different devices, but different kinds of devices together. This is something that we're actively working on. So feature teams in Milestone are working on this extension to smart maps and alarms, guided by research that we've already done. So this is a very different approach to getting research out into the real world than the one that you might be used to, where I say, yeah, wait a few years. So, with that, I'd like to thank you very much. I'd like to give credit to these people and enjoy the rest of the conference.